Hi, everyone. Hi, everyone. We are just allowing a short time for participants to join as the numbers are going up. So good afternoon. My name is Elena Crippa. I'm a curator of modern contemporary British art at Tate. It is my great pleasure to welcome you to today's session, or indeed welcome you back to what has been a truly energizing week of interlacing discussions involving the materiality, gathering of sources, labor, and of course ideas underpinning different forms of collage from the post-war period to the present day. Today we are gathering for the last day of this week's webinar, while the conference will continue next week in a different format with two online workshops on Wednesday and Thursday, for which I know many of you have already booked a ticket. And there is also a waiting list, I think, running with a few more spaces, I hope, to accommodate last minute participants. Today we are here to discuss collage, politics and punk practices, a session dedicated primarily to artists who, since the 70s and 80s, have adopted collage and photomontage as a tool or method to trouble received histories, participate in gender and class struggle, interrogate the ways in which images and identities are constructed, and produce new and nuanced histories to reflect the experience of diasporic communities in the UK. I would like to thank all the speakers and chairs contributing to our session today for sharing their research and their insight with us. And before introducing the panel, I should just run through some housekeeping. So the session is divided in two panels with a short break in halfway. There will be time for discussion and questions after each panel, and hopefully also for an overall discussion at the end. So please do engage, use the chat function to get in touch, send comments and feedback, and type your questions in the Q&A function at the bottom of the bar. The session is being recorded and will be available online, and we also have a live transcript function. So it is my great pleasure to introduce Catherine Grant, who is chairing our first panel. Catherine is senior lecturer in the Art and Visual Cultures Department at Goldsmiths University of London, and she's currently researching the legacies of feminist histories in contemporary art. Among her recent publications is A Letter Sent, Waiting to be Received, Queer Correspondence, Feminism and Black British Art from 2019. She's the co-editor of Fandom as Methodology with Kate Random Love from 2019, as well as the collection Girls, Girls, Girls 2011 and Creative Writing and Art History from 2012. And she's also co-edited the questionnaire, Decolonizing Art History with Dorothy Price for Art History, which was published last year. So welcome, Catherine, and I hand over to you.
Thank you very much. Welcome, everyone. I've been enjoying this week's conference so much, and I'm really delighted to be chairing this first panel on two very important artists, Linder Sterling and Chila Burman. Also, I've enjoyed the writing of both of our speakers for a number of years. So our first speaker is Amy Tobin, who is a lecturer in the Department of History of Art at Cambridge, and also a curator of contemporary programmes at Kettle's Yard. She's published her research in Tate Papers, Mirage, Women, a Cultural Review, and Feminist Review, along with book chapters in a number of edited books. She's the co-editor of London Art World's Mobile, Contingent and Ephemeral Networks, and The Art of Feminism. As you probably know, Amy's curated numerous exhibitions at Kettle's Yard, including the 2020 retrospective of Linder Sterling that she will discuss as part of her paper. She is working on a number of amazing upcoming exhibitions, including one that is about to open on the work of Shutapa Biswas. In 2019-20, Amy was the Terra PMC Fellow, and she currently has a Leverhulme Research Fellowship to work on a new project on art and feminist sisterhoods. And today her paper is entitled I Can't Swim, I Have Nightmares, Linder and Photomontage. And I'll hand over to Amy.
Thank you, Catherine. So I hope everyone can see and hear everything as appropriately, but just shout out if you can't. I step into a white icebox, cold, shiny tube, tiny black holes. I close my eyes, I turn it on. I close my eyes, I turn it on. So goes the song, I Can't Swim, I Have Nightmares by Ludus, the post-punk band that the artist Linder, sometimes also known as Linder Sterling, fronted from 1977 to the mid-1980s. The repeating lyrics of the song make up only one portion of the multiple fragmented passages, which also includes staccato drum beats and falls, cymbal tingles, a three-part bass line, an interjecting run of saxophone, prolonged guitar chords, and vocal howls. Each part seems separate, introduced in fragments that repeat again and again, eventually overlaying in a sonic landscape that emulates the strange reverbs of submerged sound, eventually a new refrain of lyrics, I'm hot, I'm cold, I'm in control, repeat and repeat until the song finishes with a crescendo, all the instrumental fragments and voice fragments in sync. The lyrics refer to a shower in a gym in Deansgate, Manchester, where Linder practiced weightlifting. She describes staring at the showerhead, anticipating the prick of icy water, and linking this experience to the shower scene in Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho. I had, she has explained to me, nightmares about landscapes flooding, tides rising, drowning for decades. I can't swim, I have nightmares, pushes the nightmarish scenarios of confinement and attack against control and the strength to keep one's head above the water to keep from drowning. The liquid motifs in this emblematic song extend across Linder's work, often only implicitly present and sometimes hidden or frozen in the dried glue that suspend the separate parts of her photomontages together. The song was first released on Ludus's 1980 EP, The Visit, which includes four other songs, each a mini thesis on gender, sexuality, domesticity, childhood, and menstruation, rendered in commanding shouts, lilting refrains, punchy singing, smooth aria, falsetto calls, shrieks, deep howls, and trembling gargles. Linder uses her voice in all kinds of variations, verbal and non-verbal, sometimes melding extra-linguistic effect with wordy exhortations. This EP and the subsequent releases over the following 5 years is not really the music of punk characterized as it was by short, sharp songs with catchy mantras, heavy riffs and speed. Most people claim it as post-punk, the intellectual art school version of a working class mode that ripped up convention and made it anew, to paraphrase the title of Simon Reynolds' influential book. But Ludus and Linder are folded into post-punk where they don't quite fit and connected to punk because of the milieu of the band we're a part of, and particularly because of Linder's connections to Buzzcocks and Magazine, for whom she famously made artwork for album covers and with whose members she was good friends. But Ludus's music was not a subsumption to a current, but a wanton disturbance organized around Linder using her voice and language in concert with sound, performance, and printed matter. The covers of The Visit and The Seduction, released a year later in 1981, provide indexes for Linder's interests at this moment. Both the monochromatic with graphic paper collages or line drawings that trace profile views of faces, mask-like representations of the band that also continued in the sleeve. The Seduction also includes a drawing of an abstracted tree signifying menstruation, a theme extended on the back cover in the form of a figure trussed in strappy bondage lingerie and menstrual pads. The band was originally titled Blood Sports, referencing both the upper class pastime of fox hunting and the colloquial term for sex during menstruation. Linder stuck with the theme, but opted for the de-anglicized ludus from the Latin for games and sports, as she had done earlier with the transformation of her own name, Linda, to Linder. And Ludus's style is a kind of collapse of Aubrey Beardsley decadence, feminist critique and Dada edge in the same way that her name, you know, itself performs that combination. This is an intuitive combination of queer sensuality, objection, and post-industrial grit, pointed at the macho chauvinism of the factory scene as much as to any other establishment. The graphic form, I think, signals it on the cover, but the full force of this collision came to pass in the photo performances, realized with the collaboration of Beera, the live performances with her band, of course, in the music too. This was a total artwork, and Linder has continued to pursue this form in her ballets and tableau performances, which she's described as expanded collage, often with her Bowers of Bliss, which is also a citation from another Luda song, Vagina Gratitude, bringing themes of earlier works into the present. Linder's photomontages often do this complex work on a single surface. Sometimes she brings things together suspended in a dialectical tension, familiar from Dadaist montage, but just as often her photomontages achieve a strange kind of synthesis, something that feels right, even if it's visually jarring. And Linder has laid the clues out in her careful selection of materials for juxtaposition, which are often more proximate than antithetical, as well as her interest in themes like metamorphosis, movement, and to put it plainly, just sticking things together. The photomontages let the chaos in, they admit the desire and the trauma that are otherwise in abeyance. So over the past 3 years, I've been working with Linder, as Catherine said, on an exhibition that became Linderism at Kettle's Yard. And the aim of this project was to give Linder her first kind of survey exhibition in the UK following Linder Femme Objet in Paris in 2013 and the group exhibition House of Fame at Nottingham Contemporary in 2018. And there were many, many elements to this exhibition that pulled out themes from her practice relating to performance, mysticism, spirituality, memorial, body modification, the senses, modernism, many of which entwined with the histories of Kettle's Yard. But perhaps one of the most important decisions we made in relation to photomontage was to mark a decisive shift in Linder's use of this form in particular. In the first section of Gallery One, we concentrated on earlier works, those made in the late 1970s and early 1980s, many produced over a few months in the winter of 1976-7, while in the second gallery, we included a selection of photomontages Linder has made since 2005, when she returned to the process in earnest after a break of at least 20 years. Linder and I discussed these two paces as a descent into the underground and an ascent to paradise, respectively. The underground was the radical hell of her early years, a time of confusion and anger, but also a reference to the constraint of continually being associated with an earlier self and an iconic moment. Paradise wasn't any religious heavenly equivalent, but a kind of journey into infinite possibility. The room was called Paradise Experiments, gesturing to the more exploratory, sensuous, and pleasurable, as we said in the wall text, tendencies of the later works, contra the incisive cuts and interventions of the 70s. And in my essay for the catalogue that accompanied the exhibition, which was titled The Red Period, I narrated a transgressive feminism in Linder's art that spills from the earlier to the later works and that purposefully unsettles the taxonomic, the structural, and the temporal. In the exhibition too, Linder and I played with modes of display. On the wall in gallery two, we traced a narrative progression across diverse works, then prioritized other formal affinities in a dense cluster hang that you see on the screen here. We also modeled her 1970s lingerie masks like sculptural busts, and we let later works creep in between earlier ones like weeds, and place the iconic photo montages in disjunctive rhythms on bright white and vibrant red walls. The aim was to suggest order and then let the work resist it. We were precise in our disordering and we stopped when it stuck. So we often connect photo montage, as this symposium does in its title, with the act of cutting and consequently with precision. We associate this precision also with investigation, with the cut, with intervention. And the photomontage artist can see things differently, perhaps more clearly. They can slice through the rhetoric, revealing something marvelous or a comedic effect. And Dawn Adder's classic text, which itself inspired Linder to begin Photomontage, traces the varieties of technique that range from the didactic to the automatic, the transformation of relationships between familiar objects to magnifying focus. In 1976, when Linder began, Photomontage was a more direct way of engaging with the printed matter and popular imagery that she had already been drawn to in her practice through drawing and non-photomontage, I think we could call the work on the bottom. The act of cutting was part of the attraction. It was a means of giving something ugly back to the world, made from its images of beauty and desire, both pornographic and consumerist. It was a cool medium without expression, which Linder leant into, enjoying the idea of being a monteur, an engineer of culture rather than an artist, something that wittily fulfilled the expectations of her family, who cut a deal with her to attend a graphic design course rather than a fine art one, since it had better career prospects. The engineer worked with a scalpel, and Linder chose a Swan Morton with a number 11 blade that allowed her to trace the outlines of bodies, foodstuff, furniture, stationery, and other consumer goods from all kinds of paper stock. The poetic associations of the act were not lost on her. She called the works of this moment a cultural post-mortem, acknowledging the apocalyptic sensibility of 1970s Britain, especially seen from the aspect of the North. In 1978, she contributed four of her photo montages to mixed media montages, a portfolio also including the work of Edward Bell, Ian Pollock, George Snow, and Ian Savage, which was conceived of as a Dadaist dispatch from the end game of bourgeois Britain. While other contributors engaged with world events, urban politics, and dilapidated masculinity, Linder turned her attention to kitchens and bedrooms. In these and other works made that year, she engaged with themes of binding, holding, and the restriction of the senses to critique the heteronormative and gender normative disciplining of the home. There is much to say about these works and all their various effects, but blindness and or not seeing are important for now. Often, vision is made a central theme in these works. The eyes of figures are replaced with new ill-fitting ones or by technology, cameras or televisions instead. Sometimes eyes are pierced or we can track the burn marks from the cigarette that originally erased them. In one sense, these shifts thematize photomontage itself as a process of visual transformation, one aimed at puncturing the culture of spectacle, distraction, and alienation. But they also speak to Linder's particular experience of sexual abuse, of being forced to look at pornographic images as a child by a family member. The imperative to look, to be forced to see, is problematized in these works. And yet at the same time, Linder's combination of pornographic material with scenes of bourgeois domesticity also recirculates this imagery. This is an act of exposure, a revelation of taboo that speaks to the entanglement of trauma and sublimation. There was one work in Linderism that always compelled me, and it's from a series Linder made that engages with Barbara Hepworth, in which figures are punctuated by voids in Hepworth-esque style. However, these voids are made by overlaid images of furniture or glassware or cutlery rather than cutting away. The figures are all taken from fashion plates circa 1970-75, the last years of Hepworth's life when she was physically incapacitated, coincidentally also the early years of the women's liberation movement. This photo montage shows a model, Marie Helvin, floating in a pool, hands on head, between strokes with eyes closed, apparently swimming and sleeping. Overlaying her are four crystal bowls, two empty, one containing a lit candle, one a split avocado sans core, along with a downturned knife, fork and spoon. The cutlery and bowls are not subject to the same forces as the body in the water. They extend it into space and play upon it. The diagonal line of the three bowls seems to propel outwards, while the parallel lines of the cutlery press down, classic photomontage style. The works in this series transform images of worldly, fashionable women with spatial vectors culled from modern sculpture. The figures mesh with their environments, are punctured by objects of domestic ritual, and are suspended in pose, in step, or flow. These works are about bodies in space and in the world and in relation, still held in place, but subject to flow. This figure, the Mary Helvin, might be the protagonist of the Luda song, on the cusp of drowning for decades, as Linda described her nightmares, or balancing toward the ascent from the underground. As part of Linderism, we commissioned Linda to make some new works for the house. And these would be cuts in the static can first put in place by Jim and Helen Ead, who lived and founded Kettle's Yard before gifting it to the University of Cambridge. And Linda took this opportunity to return some of the multisensorial qualities of a home to what is now a museum, what is Kettle's Yard. She made an audio work, a new version of Vagina Gratitude, and we made Jimmy's recipe for potpourri. The scents were a means of pushing against the fixed tableau of the house to incite new sensorial associations. And I think this was a kind of extension of her photomontage process. They refer to abjection and cleanliness, to femininity and desire, and to liquidity in tension with solidity. And this theme in particular was also manifested in a series of glass vessels Linda made with the glass worker Jochen Holtz, which you see on the screen here. These are tumescent forms, apparently soft but petrified. They were named for alchemical objects, here Helleborada, some opaque and some sprouting thick bolts of wavy hair, some transparent and balanced in careful relation to their surroundings, as if poised to dispense some kind of fragrance. The sensorial interruptions Linda embedded in the house were a means of recalibrating the space. Both the specific static feeling that follows decades of museum petrification and generally the tenor of domesticity. It was a kind of accelerator to motion, which is, I think, a tendency, a drive perhaps, of Linda's recent work. We can see it in her interest in ballet dancers or more recently football players that echo with Merce Cunningham's leaps, or in her tuning into the spirit of Ithel Colquhoun. And I should say, actually, just here's a little preview of a Linda photomontage before it stuck down on the right hand side of the screen. Or we can also see this drive to motion right in her turning to the spirit of Ithel Colquhoun and the automatism of hermantic stain technique, which Linda has applied to both printed matter and to actual bodies, including her own, that sort of still viscosity. And beyond this automatism, Linda has also recently suspended her controlled cutting with scalpel by leaving that tool behind for a pair of dressmaker's shears. These unwieldy tools remove the possibility of precision so that Linda's cuts no longer conform to the edge of a form, but take on new sinuous shapes. These parts are built up on denser surfaces, no longer the found expanses of a single page or a patchwork landscape, but instead spiraling vortexes and vertiginous levels. These photomontages do not speak of disturbance or intervention or juxtaposition, I think, but are a kind of condensation of things beyond codification, a transformation that sparks something new. And perhaps this is most obvious in a new work, this work, which I'm going to show you a part of. Called And the Space Like a Root, which transforms a Super 8 film made by the photographer and pornographer Harrison Marks, who is featured in earlier works, with a series of overlays and interventions, images of and from Linda's oeuvre ghost onto Marks's banal footage or appear in channels that bisect it. It is Linda's first digital animated moving image work, with a cast of new characters and locales, the slow movements of the model protagonists of Marx's footage are divorced from any static relation to the voyeuristic camera. They become choreographic. A scene in which a woman in a bubble bath is transformed into something ritual-like as her body is interspersed with color-filtered close-ups of hands, nails, foliage, faces and shoes, then juxtaposed with passages of liquid flow and unfreezing of the fixed enamels of the mantic stain process. This is a fugue-like ascendancy away from the mundane prurience of this bathroom scene. And with this work, made with the iPhone camera used like a planchette, the balance slips, the control slips, and something else opens up in Linda's work beyond the nightmare to something like paradise.
Thank you so much, Amy. That was a really fabulous presentation, and so much there in Linda's work, and great to see what's sort of occurring in her practice right up to the present day. So please think of your questions, and we'll have questions together after Alice's paper. So I'm now going to introduce the next speaker, Alice Correia, who's an art historian. Her research examines late 20th century British art with a specific focus on artists of African, Caribbean and South Asian heritage. She is currently research curator at Touchstones Rochdale and is organising a fantastic looking conference entitled The Radical Decades, Art, Activism and Regional Galleries in the 1980s Britain, which will take place there in January 2022. She's previously worked at Tate Britain, the Government Art Collection and Sussex and Salford Universities. In 2017, she was a mid-career fellow at the Paul Mellon Centre, where she initiated her ongoing research project, Articulating British Asian Art Histories. She's currently working on a monograph provisionally titled South Asian Women Artists in Britain. I really can't wait to read that. You need to read it quickly, please. And her articles have appeared in Art History, British Art Studies, Journal of British Visual Culture, and Nikkar Journal of Contemporary African Art. And she's also the chair of trustees of the journal Third Text. And I'm delighted to welcome her to present her paper on Chila, Kumari, Burman, Punk, Punjabi Protest. Thanks, Alice.
Thanks. Thanks, Catherine. Hello, everyone. Let's see. Right. So it's fairly astonishing to me that in the time since I wrote my abstract for this conference paper in 2019, Chila Burman's work has reached an incredible number of people. I don't think any of us, I don't think any of us truly anticipated the overwhelmingly positive public and critical response to her Tate Britain Winter Commission, which was on display earlier last year and earlier this year. And so it continues. This autumn, Chila's neons and collages have been reinstalled and supplemented with new work at Covent Garden. And this installation is on until Sunday, so you've got a couple of days to see it. Now, throughout her career, her works on paper, photos, silkscreen prints, and multimedia works have utilized archival family photographs, images amassed from magazines and books, and the material culture of everyday life, and are often embellished with jewels, bindi, and other decorative elements. Her recent commissions have repeated and reused images, motifs, and textual phrases found in earlier works, including, for example, her father's ice cream van, which you can see in the bottom print, which is then repeated on the steps of Tate Britain. So Burman's brightly coloured, often kitsch aesthetic, which combines Indian reference with a sensibility that embraces northern working class culture, belies her nuanced and active participation in racial, gender and class struggle. If we accept that the material form of collage is steeped in a history of dissent, interrogation and destabilization, then it's possible to argue that the form of Burman's engagement with the strategies of collage and montage, in addition to her subject matter, is a manifestation of her challenge to bourgeois ideals, elitist conceptions of art, and her anti-hierarchical approach to art making. Indeed, Burman has cited Kurt Schwitters as an early influence, and Linda Need has posited her work as a reworking of, quote, the Dadaist concept of the found object seen through the filter of 1970s art school punk. Following decades of intellectual neglect, Black and Asian artists active in Britain during the 1980s are currently receiving increased attention. And on the surface of things, her Tatement Commission perhaps shows Burman as a beneficiary of those art historical revaluations. However, the point I wanted to make in this paper back in 2019 was, and I think still stands, critical engagement with Burman's work in the field of Black British art has been limited to her work in the 1980s. And critical engagement of any sort in broader art historical studies remains negligible. But despite her persistent use of collage, montage, and printing techniques that overlay found images, she's curiously absent from accessible publications on collage. And if anyone knows of any, I'd be really happy to hear about them. There's also a particular silence around her work using bright, vibrant colors from the 1990s and 2000s, which I'll discuss a bit later. This state of affairs, I think, is somewhat remarkable, given that Cubbon and Mercer has identified collage as a significant trend in Black artistic practice. Across the work of Rashida Reen and Eddie Chambers and others, he's noted that a cut and mix aesthetic, whereby artworks comprising handmade and collated images, texts and objects were selected, manipulated and positioned in proximity in order to express something of the lived diasporic experience. Indeed, Mercer has argued that the formal dynamics of collage are especially relevant to the hyphenated character of diaspora identities. So today I'm going to introduce two broad categories of Burman's engagement with collage, which I also define quite broadly, in order to demonstrate her clear understanding of this mode of collating, manipulating, and juxtaposing images as radical, subversive, and expressive of a culture that is counter to the mainstream. I will suggest that through her use of collage, Burman addresses the multiplicity of South Asian identities within a British context, proposing that these identities resist homogeneity and stasis. And I'll conclude with some thoughts regarding the critical silences around her work. So Burman was one of the first Black women artists in the country to produce political work. And one of her most significant works from the 80s was the diptych Convenience Not Love of 1987, 6-7, which utilizes the image of Margaret Thatcher and a British passport to present a scathing indictment of British immigration policy in the post-1945 era, highlighting the hypocrisy of successive British governments, and provides a commentary on the institutionalized racism that impacted on the everyday lives of ordinary working class people, such as Burman and her family. The left-hand panel comprises three areas. Moving from left to right, a jostling column of police and male figures encircle a photocopy of the South African athlete, Zola Budd. To the right of these figures is an old, now new, style British passport. In the windows of the passport is Urdu script written by the artist's father, which reads, "You allow us to come here on false promises. We come here full of hope and destiny. You have no mercy. We will struggle and survive. Long live, long live, long live." Overlapping the passport and encroaching onto the adjacent field of gold is barbed wire, which leads us to the figure of Margaret Thatcher, dressed in John Bull, standing in front of a Union flag. A vivid green speech bubble expands from her mouth, and the words in Gothic script reads, "That if there's any fear that it might be swamped, people are going to react and be rather hostile." These words were spoken by Thatcher during a television interview in 1978 and refer to the fears of ordinary white British people that their country might be swamped with foreigners should immigration levels remain the same. In the interview, Thatcher would go on to suggest that immigration from the Commonwealth, and particular from Pakistan, was unsustainable. Now, clearly, Burman's use of Thatcher can be placed within a wider narrative of satirical photo montage from the 80s. But what's important here is the isolation of the Prime Minister on the golden ground. As Dawn Addis has proposed in constructing a collage, the isolation of an object can be as important as its incongruous juxtapositions. And looking towards her right, Thatcher seems to be speaking to and about the people who populate Burman's right-hand panel, where family photographs, manipulated found images, hand-drawn cartoon strip imagery circulate around a row of passports from Sri Lanka, Pakistan, India, and Bangladesh. Now, when the work was first shown at the Cooper Gallery in Barnsley in 1988, you can see that the work was shown in the reverse order, but you can also perhaps see that the assemblage on the right-hand panel was a bit sparser and also doesn't have the Sri Lankan passport, which was added at a later date. So we might want to think about how Burman continues to reformulate and manipulate her collages. And here is an example of how Chila has intervened with her source material. From a distance, this panel appears as a manifestation of the swarms of Asian people chaotically positioned who threaten to spill over into the sparsely populated gold and pleasant land that Thatcher so fiercely protects. The visual excess mimics Thatcher's swamping metaphor while simultaneously critiquing her isolationism. However, on closer examination, we can see that Burman's collaged images are not chaotically positioned, but are in fact, I think, quite orderly. Images overlap infrequently. They're given their own space and lead the eye around the central row of passports in syncopated rhythms, the larger images anchoring the smaller ones. Nonetheless, as Eve Lomax observed in her discussion of montage, no matter how tightly controlled, something will always exceed, something will always spill over, break out, disrupt and displace. And this will bring as much fear as joy, as much pleasure as pain. And I want to suggest here that Burman's use of collage to activate this tension, uses collage to activate this tension and anticipation of the potential of spillage to considerable effect in this work. Her utilization of collage also articulates the anti-essentialist understanding of South Asian identity. Indeed, the presence of the four passports, there is a resistance to the notion that people from diverse cultures from a vast geographical area can be reduced to a single nomenclature. Simultaneously, in their quotidian plenitude, Burman's assemblages of images demonstrates a reflexive awareness of history, representation, and the importance of images in shaping social attitudes towards race and gender. So throughout her career, Burman has had a clear ambition to draw attention to the complexity and multifaceted nature of female British Asian identities. In the top left-hand corner of the panel, she includes an image of women crouched despondently. Citing this image as an example of the stereotype that casts South Asian women as meek and passive victims, Burman challenges its veracity. In its antagonistic proximity to other images of Burman and her family, of women on picket lines with placards, unequivocally stating, "We will not be slaves." Burman harnesses the operation of collage in order to cut, break, open up, and expand the range of visual reference about and available to women of South Asian heritage. In her choice and juxtaposition of images that challenge reductive stereotypes, Burman also constructed a matrilineal history of resilient and powerful women, which includes the Rani of Jhansi, who in 1857 led the Indian rebellion against the British in India, with participants in the industrial action at the Grumwick Film Processing Laboratory in London in 1976-7. As such, she creates a dialogic space for rethinking South Asian female identities. And it's my contention here that Burman's point is underscored by her mode of working, where, as Lomax asserted, The politics of montage concerns the way in which we negotiate heterogeneity and multiplicity. Now, Burman's highly nuanced engagements with the vicissitudes of South Asian womanhood, as evinced in Convenience Not Love, is reiterated in her pop photomontage self-portraits from the 1990s. This series of works, collectively titled Autoportraits, utilize multiple repeated and resized photographs presented in a hyper-vibrant color palette. In 28 positions in 35 years, Burman offers 28 psychedelic self-portraits presented in a grid. Images have been manipulated, enlarged, cropped, repeated, and flipped. Blocked stripes, swirling spirals, dots, dashes, and linear rays rendered in an array of yellow, pink, green, blue, variously overlap the photographic images and collectively create a frenetic composition which demands the viewer's attention but resists a settled viewing experience. And I thought it was really interesting that David Mellor was talking about collage and the Beatles in his opening talk. And I wondered whether there is reference to a sort of a Liverpudlian Beatles visual culture in Chila's work. But of course, this work, this Richard Avedon poster, clearly also refers to the Beatles' psychedelic trip to India. So there's a neat circularity there. And with this, I'd like to return to my earlier question about how do we account for the critical silences around Burman's work from the 1990s and 2000s. It's not insignificant that the first of her works to enter the Tate collection were gritty and somber etchings and photolithographs made in the early 1980s that addressed issues such as the anti-apartheid struggle and anti-nuclear protest, which could be more easily accommodated within narratives of protest art at the time. And Sophie Orlando has suggested that Burman's work, quote, resists interpretation. But I don't think that this is entirely right. Instead of being resistant to critical interpretation, I would like to propose that these vibrant collages and sculptures fall foul of a number of intersecting biases within art history, including, but not limited to, chromophobia, racism, and misogyny. So David Batchelor has discussed, there is a pervasive chromophobia within Western aesthetics, and it's my contention that Burman's work, particularly those works from this period that you can see on screen, have been dismissed as too bright, too frenetic, and simply too much. Batchelor has asserted that across Western art, quote, color has been systematically marginalized, reviled, diminished, and degraded. Bright color, he explains, has become regarded as other, usually the feminine, the oriental, the primitive, the infantile, the vulgar, the queer, or the pathological. And it's perhaps been too easy to regard Burman's use of so-called feminine, non-Western color in these hierarchical, elitist, and dismissive terms. We can expand upon Batchelor's proposition of color as synonymous with primitive or oriental through Partha Mitter's important work on the reception of Indian art in Britain. In his landmark book, Much Maligned Monsters, A History of European Reactions to Indian Art, Mitter demonstrated that, quote, colonial art historians, almost without exception, were disturbed by the rich polychrome surface decoration of South Indian temples, which they described as tasteless, overripe, and decadent. Mitter went on to explain that, quote, far from being natural, these stylistic categories were essentially neoclassical criticisms of non-classical art, which failed to, the criticism was that these were non-classical artworks, and they failed to replicate what Winckelmann saw as the noble simplicity and quiet grandeur of Greek art. So what does this mean? What does it mean to collage the temple of British art with its neoclassical columns and refined grandeur with bright neon and ornate stylings of a Scouse Punjabi punk feminist? While this collage was unquestionably joyous, bright, sparkly, and flamboyant, placing Hindu icons, female Bollywood actors, and decorative pattern works across the facade of the gallery, it was also an act of disruption, which, amongst other things, demanded a reconsideration of how the gallery acts as gatekeeper, as an arbiter of good taste, and how, and we might well wonder, if and when her psychedelic work will cross the threshold or even move beyond the anteroom into the main gallery. So to conclude, as a subversive challenge to colonialism and the legacies of colonialism which underpin narratives of British art, narratives which failed to make space for artists working with South Asian visual culture, it seems entirely right that the grand public face of the National Collection was glitter bombed with South Asian excess that both unsettled aesthetic convention and national parameters. Through her mashup, the mixing and manipulation of found, made, collated visual resources, Burman unapologetically challenges ethno-national exclusions and ruptures European aesthetic niceties. Burman's Winter Commission was an evolution of her early engagement with collage and her experiments with color during the 1990s. Conjoining the spectacular of pop with a diasporic hybridity, combining the simulacral and the referential, Burman demonstrates that serious themes can be addressed in forms that initially seem incongruous. They should be properly regarded as knowingly nuanced and playful engagements with the complexity and multicultural nature of contemporary Britain. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Alice. That was a really fantastic presentation and really gave an insight into Burman's practice, again, right up to the present. I think what sort of joins both of these presentations is trying to think about two artists whose practice has kind of spread across a number of decades, and putting them alongside each other kind of really draws out their differences as well. And that's something we might explore in the questions. I was thinking about the contrast between all the eyes in Burman's self-portraits and all the kind of blindness or kind of closed eyes or absent faces in Linder's, and how they kind of differently access histories of collage, both very politically, but sort of in quite different traditions. I would encourage people to type any questions they have into the Q&A box. We have got 15 minutes for questions now. And Amna Malik has already posted some questions. Great to have you here, Amna, and thank you for your questions. So what I'll do is I'll turn to her questions and I'll read them out. She's got one question for Amy and then one question for Alice. So Amna's question to Amy is, can you say something more about Linder's 2015 automism titled Collage and collage as a process of punk possibilities? Bit of a tongue twister.
Yeah. So those are the super automatism series, I think, which are usually, or they're combinations of either ballet dancers or sort of these health magazine figures taken from health magazines. Which have the mantic stain technique overlaid on the surface. So those I think, well, it's interesting because we, in the exhibition, we didn't really call these works photomontages, right? Because they're not, they're one page of magazine with enamel. They were one of those things that kind of crept into these, you know, unsettling the taxonomies mode that we were trying to kind of do. Under the cover of the like hyper organization of this exhibition, which was somebody described to me as very academically curated, which I thought was a bit critical. But, so what do they have to do with punk? I don't know really. I mean, I think punk is a kind of difficult word in that it means so many different things to so many people and also like the same thing to others. And I think, to me, those works speak more to surrealism or to like spiritualism, things that have long been interests of Linder's from the 70s, you know, to the present, and are much much more important in a way than some of those kind of punk associations as they manifested in music culture in the mid 70s. But I think you probably could read them as punk small p in lots of ways in terms of thinking about, you know, going against the grain of kind of established knowledge and epistemology. But,
yeah. Thank you. And now there's a question for Alice, again from Amna Malik. Alice, could you say something about the sense of excess in Chila's work and Orientalism? And I think you started to address this at the end in your really interesting discussion of primophobia, but I don't know if you'd like to elaborate on that at all.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Amna, for your question. I have to be honest and say this is really new, and it's only something I've been thinking about recently in preparation for this today. And it's, I think just thinking about what Partamissa was writing about in terms of European receptions of Indian art as excessive, as seeing Indian temples as excessive and over-stylized. And one of the words that was used that Mitta identifies, one of the words that was used was to describe these temples and Hindu visual culture as decadent, pejoratively. And I think we can perhaps see that in the relation between sort of Western art history and the rise and fall of decoration and ornament, and how there is a moment, a Victorian moment, where the decorative is highly praised and valued at a moment of high colonialism. And then we get the stripping back of ornament and decoration in minimalism. And I think there is something about that rise and fall in art history that I want to explore in relation to Chila's work and way in which she is currently using neon that is different to the history of the use of neon in contemporary art. So how is Chila's work in neon different to Bruce Nauman's, for example? I think there's lots of things to unpick, and I'm still really at the beginning of that.
Thank you, Alice. And Amna, I don't know if you want to come in with any comments. If you want to, I think that is a possibility. But in the meantime, I'm going to go to a question from Victoria Horn. She says, fantastic papers, thank you. And she says, both of your papers address collage in an expanded sense beyond the page. Could you explain how you have chosen to define collage? And this is something that I think is so active in both of their practices that we kind of know them most for their kind of their paper-based collage works. But what both your presentations showed us was how they are then take that sensibility into all different kinds of practices. So I don't know which one of you would like to go first on that.
I can go, Amy, if you want. So Chila's work, if you look at her expanded body of work, she repeats and reuses and reformulates the same motifs again and again. So in her current Covent Garden installation, she has the tiger. The tiger was in the Tate Britain commission. The tiger features on top of her dad's ice cream van. So these motifs repeat. And if we're thinking about collage in an expanded sense of the reiteration of motifs in different ways and in different places in order to unpick what that motif might be, I think we have to look at understand collage beyond the piece of paper. I mean, it's the way my understanding of how Chila works is that she has these ideas, and they're circulating in her head, and she has this sort of memory bank of images that she will utilize according to the situation or the thing that she's working on. So to say that that collage is this one technique of cutting and pasting on paper, I think is sort of antithetical to her way of working.
Thank you. Amy, do you want to respond in terms of Linda's practice?
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting question, because it is a word that sometimes gets thrown around. And in Linda's case, maybe the way I would think about it is that actually printed matter, and so photomontage, right, specifically rather than collage, was really important in helping her to define a practice in the 70s when she was drawing from films and magazines, or kind of starting to use printed materials in relation to other paper. So paper and the specificity of photomontage and collage to that material, I think, is important to Linda's work. But I also think there's an overemphasis on the idea of the cut, and I'll fully open up to that. You know, I definitely sort of started off that project of thinking about Linda's work through intervention and cutting and incision. But, you know, more and more, and really led by Linda, I think what's important is the sticking and the glue and this kind of materiality that could move beyond just the paper, just the image, just the flat surface. And I think the glue is a nice way to think about how that's already inherent in those modes, and Linda's work, you know, by its existence kind of goes into all of these different expanded terrains.
Thank you. I think a history of collage that focuses on glue could be really interesting, and maybe joins up with the idea of the glitter bomb. Because in my mind, I've got these two models, this sort of water, like trying to sort of return to the water in Linda, and then this sort of glitter bomb in Shyla's work, and like these two different models of kind of reconfiguring sort of available material. But anyway, I'm going to return to the questions. Thank you for those responses. I've got a question from Nicholas Brown, again for Alice. Thanks, Alice, that was a brilliant presentation. It's a really good point about the critical erasure of the later works of many of the 1980s BAM artists. I feel some of Burman's 1990s works, such as the autoportraits, have been exhibited in a number of shows over the last decade, but that these shows haven't been reviewed, to his knowledge, in any mainstream British art press. Do you have any further thoughts on possible reasons for this inattention?
Yeah, thanks, Nicholas. Yeah, it's a really important question, and one that I've been grappling with myself, in as much as, you know, in identifying the fact that the works from the 1990s and early 2000s haven't been discussed broadly. I have to see myself as being complicit in that, in as much as my first engagement academically with Shyla's work was with the works from the 1980s. And I have to ask myself, well, why was it that I felt more comfortable working on those clearly political works rather than the bright pop pink stuff. Even when we know that those works have been widely reproduced, they're on, it's on the front cover of, so I just had one, I was just looking at one this morning and now I can't see it. So why don't I think these works have been looked at? I think there is a real problem with the ways in which art history historicizes artists into a cultural art historical moment of the 80s, and very hard to look at an expanse of an artist's work across decades unless you're doing a big monographic retrospective. And I said, I think there's a hesitancy with the 1990s work that at that moment, there was a resistance to overtly feminist works. There was a resistance to overtly girly works. I mean, I think Shyla's talked about her work as wanting, as being girly and liking pink and fluffy stuff, and unashamedly, and why not? But if we think about the 90s, we have a lad culture, we have the ladette, and that kind of framing of gender politics. Charlie's work doesn't fit within that framing of gender politics in the 90s. So I think that's one reason. And as I said, I'm just beginning to think about sort of an art historical, a broader art historical approach to artists who are using South Asian visual culture in their work, and a historical resistance to that type of work that doesn't conform to clean lines and balanced forms. And that's not to say that Shyla's work isn't balanced, but it's all over. But it's, again, I find it fascinating that Burman's collages aren't talked about in relation to Hannah Hock's all over collages. But yeah, I don't know if that answers your question, Nicholas, but.
I think so. Thank you, Alice. We're running out of time, so I'm going to end on one last question, which has sort of epic implications. So I'm going to ask it, and I'll sort of turn to Amy first, but maybe both of you can keep your comments brief. So Helen Legg asks if the speakers might speak to the class and regional status of the artists and whether this has impacted on the reception of their work.
Yes, I would say substantially. And there are lots of different directions one could take a response to this question. And I think maybe the one that's most generous would be that there are things in Linda's work that I think aren't really legible if you don't think about the region in that particular moment. By the region, I mean the north of England. Linda has experience of Liverpool and Manchester and lots of other places in the northwest. And I think if you don't have a sense of those places and the kind of textures of those cities and seaside towns, then you maybe lose something in translation. And there's also a thing that we talked about a lot and have discussed with lots of other people, is this idea of what Linda calls glamour in her work, and to pick up on some of what Alice has been saying about girliness, you know, this idea of wanting to like harness some of the magic, right, of dressing up or performing or transforming oneself, and femininity maybe also, and I think that's something that, you know, is takes a particular shape in the northwest and is very interesting and interestingly manifested in Linda's work.
That sounds like a wonderful extra paper. Alice, do you want to answer that question very briefly, or do you want to?
I'm just going to say what Amy said.
Fair enough. And also, I always love the kind of the idea of glamour as being a spell, you know, because that's like kind of, and there's sort of feminist writing on that. And so both artists, I think, kind of create spells in their collages. Thank you so much to both Alice and Amy, and to all the people who've put forward questions. I also believe that Chila Burman and Linda Sterling are in the audience, so I'd just like to thank them both for their amazing work, I'm sure on behalf of everyone here, and I'll hand over to Elena to say about what happens next.
Thank you so much, everyone. We take a very brief break, maximum 5 minutes, so we are back around 12 past one. See you very soon. Welcome back, everyone, for another panel and questions. Indeed, the last one of our week of discussions. We are running slightly late, so hopefully you can stay with us a bit longer if we need to overrun a bit for our multi-panel discussion. And it is now my pleasure to introduce the chair of our second panel, Elizabeth Robles, lecturer in contemporary art at the University of Bristol. Elizabeth is currently undertaking a British Academy postdoctoral fellowship for a project entitled Making Waves, Black Artists and Black Art in Britain from 1963 to 1982. And among her recent publications are Collage and Recollection, three black British artists, which was published in Wazafiri in 2019, and also is co-editor with Dorothy Price of After the Black Arts Movement, Framing the Critical Debate from 2020. So over to you, Elizabeth.
Thank you, Elena. Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you to all the organizers and to you at home for joining us. So it's my great pleasure to chair this afternoon's session and to introduce our speakers, who will continue to unravel the themes around the politics of collage and punk practices that were opened up so brilliantly by Alice and Amy in the previous panel. Our first speaker will be Allison Thompson, who will draw our focus to the collage aesthetics in the work of artist Sonia Boyce. Allison is an art historian and curator based in Barbados. She teaches in the Division of Fine Arts at the Barbados Community College and is co-director with Ewan Atkinson of Punch Creative Arena, an initiative for creative action. She has worked with a wide range of cultural organizations, including Barbados National Art Gallery Board, the Black Diaspora Visual Arts Project, ICOM Barbados, and is the president of AICA Southern Caribbean. She is the co-author of Art in Barbados, What Kind of Mirror Image? And is co-editor of Curating in the Caribbean and the forthcoming collection, Liberation Begins in the Imagination, Writings on British Caribbean Art. We will then turn to Chandra Frank, who will lead us in looking and thinking through and around the fragmentations and glimmers within archival experimentations with collage in key works by Martina Attil and Rahana Zaman. Chandra is a feminist researcher whose work lays at the intersections of archives, waterways, gender, sexuality, and race. Her curatorial practice explores the politics of care, experimental forms of narration, and the colonial grammar embedded within display and exhibition arrangements. She holds a PhD from the Department of Media Communications and Cultural Studies with an emphasis on queer and feminist studies from Goldsmiths, University of London. She's published in peer-reviewed journals and exhibition catalogs, including Feminist Review, the Small Axe VLOSA catalog, the Places Here publication, and the collection Tongues. She recently co-edited a special issue on archives for Feminist Review. Her dissertation and current book project look at the everyday experiences of the transnational feminist and queer Black migrant and refugee movement in the Netherlands during the 1980s and the role of the archive therein. She is currently postdoctoral fellow even at the Charles Phelps Taft Research Center at the University of Cincinnati. So thank you very much, and Allison, over to you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Lizzie. Share my screen. There we go. All right. I'd like to thank the organizers, the conveners, and the presenters who have all contributed to making this such a rich event. I feel very fortunate that I'm presenting on the last day and have the benefit of some really fascinating and diverse presentations that have preceded me. I particularly want to thank Elena Crippa for some of the suggestions that she made early on in conceiving this paper, and of course Sonia Boyce for a whole range of reasons, but in this context for the images of her recent installation in Manchester that she shared with me. The title of my presentation today is Come Together, Collage Aesthetics in the Work of Sonia Boyce. One of the most important recurring themes in the career of artist Sonia Boyce, which now spans almost four decades, is her fascination with bringing seemingly disparate elements together to see what new meanings might be generated. From Tarzan to Rambo, English-born native, considers her relationship to the constructed self-image and her roots in Reconstruction, from 1987. This marks an important transition in her early work from her large pastel drawings of domestic interiors to a more confrontational and radicalized commentary that relies on the collaged assemblage of diverse images and materials, resulting in troubling relationships and juxtapositions aimed at interrogating the ways in which images as well as identities are constructed. Boyce's work of the following decades focused increasingly on collaboration and performance, but I will argue her early interest in collage has informed much of this work, which can be regarded as a kind of social collage. This is evident not only in placing performers and participants in contexts which are strange or unusual for them, and in the way in which they are often asked to collaborate, but also the ways in which the materials or documents of the performance are then assembled as installations. A good example of this is Six Acts from 2018, a six-channel video mounted on an intricately designed wallpaper background. Commissioned by the Manchester Art Gallery as part of an ongoing series of invited interventions, Six Acts was presented as part of Boyce's 2018 retrospective exhibition that focused on her performative collaborations. The approach adopted by the intervention is one the artist has utilized before, engaging with communities, inviting others to perform for her in spontaneous, improvisatory, and largely unpredictable ways with complete openness to unexpected outcomes as a way to interrogate how we negotiate the dynamics of power structures and difference. The reaction to this work, however, was surprising, in fact, shocking for the artist, the curator, and the gallery, and has provided rich terrain to think through the contested relationships between institutions and the individual, particularly given the events of the last couple of years. The multifaceted performance event, as well as the subsequent compiling and layering of image in the final installation, reflect a collage aesthetic, which is often informed by Boyce's fascination with the work of the data artists. Like them, she recognizes the way that collage, whether two-dimensional, expanded into three-dimensional installations, or collaborative and spontaneous performance, has been used to challenge established and institutionalized power structures. It deliberately disrupts traditional forms and familiar narratives, thereby opening up new readings and alternative ways forward. These social collages can also be linked to feminist, queer, and diasporic aesthetics, what Stuart Hall has called the condensation of a series of overlapping, interlocking, but non-corresponding histories. Born in 1962 to parents who migrated from Barbados and Guyana as part of the Windrush generation, Sonia Boyce, OBE, is described as a British Afro-Caribbean artist who gained prominence as part of the Black Arts Movement in the UK in the early and mid 1980s with a series of large pastel drawings in which she represented herself in domestic interiors. Missionary Position 2 from 1985 is one such example. While these works reference experiences of growing up in a Caribbean household within the diaspora, they focus on the tensions of power dynamics and the intersections of gender, sexuality, race, and class, themes that have remained central to her practice. The artist is represented twice in two contrasting or juxtaposed postures. The figure on the left is in a more contained position with eyes closed, hands joined in prayer, suggesting her faithful devotion to the church, reinforced by the cross hanging on the wall above. The figure on the right, wearing a red head wrap, which Boyce associated with the Rastafari movement, is placed in a more dynamic, active pose, her hand raised as a gesture of resistance. The text below the figure reads, "They say keep politics out of religion and religion out of politics, lard, but look, my trials, nah? But when were they ever separate? Lord, give me strength." The personal is political is a feminist dictum that resonated with Boyce at this time. While these early scenes were typically located in a domestic interior, the subjective experience spoke to the larger complexities within society. Here, the resistance of a younger generation born in the UK to the traditional values of their immigrant parents, values entrenched in institutions such as the Christian church, which here becomes synonymous with European imperialism. A message reiterated in the title inscribed above the figures, "Missionary Position," followed by the words, "Position Changing." Boyce typically devotes significant attention to the decor, particularly the proliferation of patterns, seen in the details of the wallpaper and carpet, that create a flattened collage-like backdrop, as well as other carefully displayed ornaments recording the domestic setting of her family home and by extension, those of West Indian homes more generally, which would later become the subject of Michael McMillan's Front Room project. Judah Attil, in her brilliant presentation yesterday, described the influence of these works by Boyce on her early work of the 80s. And in fact, Sonia collaborated with Attil in the set of Dreaming Rivers. Boyce has said, "My use of pattern owes a lot to my mother's house. Your eyes can't stop blinking for all the pattern in the house. When you go into the living room, there are patterns everywhere, on the carpet, on the curtains, on the wallpaper, on the ceiling. They have their own coordination. I realized I was including my mother's influence, or rather a West Indian sense of decoration. The patterns, though, aren't simply there to decorate, but they're there to give clues to the picture." This becomes explicit in the four panel work, Lay Back, Keep Quiet, and Think of What Made Britain So Great. Here, Boyce has appropriated and altered a wallpaper pattern that was originally designed as a tribute to the 50th year of Queen Victoria's reign. Sorry. Windows which open into scenes of Britain's colonial exploits are transformed into crosses. She also incorporates the Victorian wallpaper patterns of William Morris, changing the red rose of the Englishness to black. In the fourth panel, Boyce appears, staring directly at the viewer as she often does, requiring more from us than just easy passive spectatorship. Jelaine Towerdross writes that the equivocal nature of the rose, whose fragility and beauty is combined with the sharpness and intractability of its thorns, becomes a metaphor for the ambivalence, not only of Britishness, but also of blackness and femininity. And She Ain't Holding Them Up, She's Holding On, from 1986, the wallpaper background, the black rose pattern, the ornamental birds, all seen in earlier works, reappear here, as does the doubling of a self-portrait, Boyce reappearing as a younger version of herself in the family portrait she balances above her head. Photographs become increasingly important points of reference, which she incorporates into the image, first as source material, but also as physical material itself, to be painted over, photocopied, and pasted. Boyce later explained, "It was the beginning of the end of drawing for me. After completing She Ain't Holding Them Up, She's Holding On, I knew there were a number of things about the way I work that needed to change." She wanted to find a new way of working, of creating work that spoke to the political issues she wanted to address, one that more directly responded to her desire to deconstruct the prevailing languages and traditions of modernism. Echoing Paul Gilroy's argument on the centrality of the Black Atlantic diasporic experience to the project of modernism, Boyce said, "One of the key things that I felt when I was at college was that modernism, though it posed as a universal language, curtailed the idea of me being a modernist simply by virtue of my being Black and female. The challenge," she recounts, "was to find a visual language to adequately describe the diasporic experience." In a recent essay on two early collages by Rashida Reen and Eddie Chambers from the 1970s, Sonia argues for the links between the materiality of collage and its ability to speak politically. And she quotes Massimiliano Gianni, "Since its very origin, collage has appeared as an art of crisis that has entertained a deep relationship with trauma and violation. There is something basic in collage, something almost guttural and visceral, that immediately connects it with rupture and intervention. It's this sense of urgency that ricochets all through the 20th century, with collage and its symbolic collisions resurfacing almost systematically at every new resurgence of collective panic and social change." This transition in her use of mixed media, particularly photographs, is evident in works such as Cricket Days, Domino Nights, Young Arrivals, New Home, Homeless, The Streets Are Paved with Gold in This Green and Pleasant Land from 1986, Interior from 1988, Talking Presence, 88, From Someone Else's Fear, Fantasy to Metamorphosis. Towerdross has remarked on Boyce's affinity for long, often convoluted and ironic or mocking titles that play with the idea of multiple and overlapping meanings and polyphonic voices. From Tarzan to Rambo, English-born native considers her relationship to the constructed self-image and her roots in reconstruction, is literally a constructed self-image incorporating photo booth snapshots juxtaposed with racist images from comic books and magazines and transferred images of printed textiles and plants. The work points to the complicity of colonial ethnographic photography, minstrelry, Hollywood films, and children's books in the continued exoticization of Blackness in British and American popular culture, and the often uncritical way in which they are consumed by audiences, both Black and white. I put this up to emphasize really, you know, the surprising scale of a number of these collages, these works. It's significant also to point out that Missionary Position 2 and From Tarzan to Rambo were acquired by Tate in 1987, when Boyce was only 25 years old. Even more remarkable, this was only the fifth time the institution had acquired the work of a female artist and the very first from a Black woman. I say this in relation to Boyce's growing interest in museums, their collecting practices, and their traditions of display. PEEP is a 1992 intervention at the Brighton Museum and Art Gallery, working with the museum's collection of African and Oceanic sculptures and making use of the dramatic lighting employed in museum displays. Boyce traced the shadows cast by the objects onto opaque tracing paper. She then cut out the shapes and used the paper to line the glass cases, temporarily obscuring or interrupting the view of the sculpture inside. Boyce's intervention focuses the viewer's attention on museological practices of display, as well as the audience's voyeuristic desire to look. Again, a theme should be returned to, notably in six acts. The two-screen video entitled Cropover was another collaboration with museums. Here, Harewood House in Leeds and the Barbados Museum and Historical Society in Barbados. It was produced in 2007 to mark the bicentenary of the abolition of the British slave trade. Harewood House remains the property of the LaSalle family, who acquired their fortune in Barbados and Jamaica in the 17th and 18th century through the buying and trading of plantations and slaves. Unlike pre-Lenten carnivals in Trinidad and Martinique and much of the Caribbean, Cropover is a harvest festival, marking the end of the sugarcane season in early August, and as such has direct ties to the plantation system of slave labor and the transatlantic trade that fueled the British Empire. Boyce's film seeks to excavate these origins from the contemporary tourist-friendly street party that is marketed and celebrated today. She makes great use of juxtapositions here, allowing the popular folk characters to transgress carefully demarcated boundaries that sought to contain this short-lived bacchanalia of mockery, cross-dressing, and power inversions. The carnivalesque would seem to share much with the aesthetic of collage. Its playful and irreverent masking, the flaunting of traditions and hierarchies, the repurposing of materials as a tool of arguably incomparable social critique and cohesion, the loss of which has been so acutely felt with its recent cancellations across the globe. Six Acts revives much of the spirit of the carnivalesque with its ability to expose and mock the refined cultural practices of the elite. It was commissioned by the Manchester Art Gallery as part of its ongoing program, the Gallery Takeover, a name which seems to invite the subversive practices of carnival, which asks contemporary artists to respond to the permanent displays. The takeover began with a series of conversations which Boyce began with the museum staff and volunteers about the permanent collection and how it's displayed and interpreted. Boyce and a group of gallery staff became specifically interested in Gallery 10, titled The Pursuit of Beauty, where a number of well-known pre-Raphaelite works were displayed. There was a marked preponderance of naked girls and women, either in the guise of the femme fatale or assuming poses of passivity. Particularly concerning were reports that Gallery 10 was popular with young girls who enjoyed taking selfies in front of the paintings and older men who came to watch them. Boyce was also drawn to a portrait of a Black man by James Northcott titled Othello, the Moor of Venice. She learned that this was actually a portrait of the renowned Shakespearean actor Ivor Aldridge, and that this portrait was the first work acquired by the gallery in 1882. Boyce noted, "It was this work that sparked the conversation that was to unfold. For me, this is a very lush painting. Ivor Aldridge, in all his theatricality, looks like a dandy. Coincidentally, Shakespeare is often associated with the term drag, dress resembling a girl. non-binary gender representation was on the agenda. The takeover aspect of the project, which took the form of an evening performance in January 2018, when Gallery 10 was temporarily renamed Whose Power on Display, Sonia invited five drag performance artists to respond to various works in the gallery. Typical of Boyce's working method, while she selected the performers and set the parameters in which the event would occur, at a certain point, she relinquished control, becoming a witness herself to the unfolding events. In discussion with the museum staff, it was decided that the sixth act would be the temporary removal of Waterhouse's painting, Hylas and the Nymphs. The work was replaced with a notice explaining that a temporary space had been left to prompt conversations about how we display and interpret artworks in Manchester's public collection. Members of the public were then invited to react by adding comments on post-it notes, which were collaged onto the surrounding wall. This final action generated an overwhelming reaction, some of it positive, much of it negative, not only on the post-it notes, but on the museum's social media and in exhibition reviews. The gallery takeover was filmed and photographed. Boyce then used this material to create a six-screen video, the monitors mounted over Boyce's signature wallpaper. Here, a collage of images of the performers framed by swags of leaves and apples, very much in the tradition of the early Victorian designs. It's interesting to look back 3 years later with the intervening controversy over the taking down of statues and the debates over exclusionary and racist practices within the museum profession. Felipe Espinoza Garrido and Ana Cristina Mendez write, "Museums and their painstakingly curated construction of history are increasingly being scrutinized for their heteronormative, androcentric, and decisively white biases, often through museum interventions. In an examination of Boyce's six acts, these authors discuss the Victorian representational paradigms, its excluding iconographies which become sites to negotiate not only hospitality, but hostility in the museum space." According to Derrida, and it was interesting that Judah Attila also made this reference yesterday in her presentation. By revisiting and rearranging MAG's permanent collection and interrelatedly the Victorian cultural legacies of art curation, the authors write, six acts makes visible and deconstructs Britain's institutionalized, gendered, and racialized discourses of conditional and sometimes withheld museal hospitality. At the same time, it inscribes itself into them as an artifact working towards a more inclusive and self-reflexive neo-Victorian approach to museal hospitality. During the process of removing the Waterhouse painting, Claire Ganaway, the gallery's curator, said, "For me personally, there's a sense of embarrassment that we haven't dealt with it sooner. We've collectively forgotten to look at this space and think about it properly." While the takeover interventions have traditionally been intended to be temporary, the Manchester Art Gallery was able to acquire six acts as part of its permanent collection, and it is now located in Gallery 10. The power of collage and the collage aesthetic is not only in what it constructs, but in what it opens up and pulls apart, and the space it makes for other ways of experiencing and expressing and knowing. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. Sorry about that. My internet dropped out. Lovely. Thank you so much, Allison. Chandra, over to you.
All right. Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for the previous presentations. It's been really interesting to listen in and to engage. So I wanted to speak today about ideas related to archives, fragmentation, diaspora, and ideas of movement. And I wanted to do it slightly different in that I wanted to use a 2017 conversation that I have had with Rahana Zaman, who's a London-based artist, and her practice is concerned with the effect of multiple social dynamics on how individuals and groups relate. Her narrative-based pieces, often deadpan and neurotic, are frequently generated through conversation and collaboration with others. And so Rahana had invited me to be in conversation in 2017 after a screening of Rahana Zaman's video, Tell Me the Story of All These Things, and Dreaming Rivers by Judah Till. And I hope by now Judah Till doesn't need introduction. I'm excited to think about both of these works. So here by a still of Rahana Zaman's work. So in Tell Me the Story of All These Things, Rahana Zaman presents a conversation and cooking demonstration with her two sisters. One sister speaks about what it means to navigate the terrains of womanhood, partnership, religion, and sexuality. And the other sister remains more on the margins. These encounters are contrasted with screenshots from the e-learning tool Prevent, which is a training program and introduction to the Prevent duty aimed to, and I quote, safeguard vulnerable people from being racialized in relationship to terrorism, and of quote, and an animated amorphous figure that submerges within a desert-like landscape. In our conversations and reflections on Zaman's work and Atil's Dreaming Rivers, we weren't so much looking for an overlap or similarity. Rather, we started the conversation by contemplating narrative structures and creating creative practices using to explore migratory experiences. Atil's Dreaming Rivers, which I know has been referenced yesterday, and I'm just including a screenshot of an essay that I wrote for a wonderful catalog, The Places Here, which is actually edited by Nick Eikens and Elizabeth Robles. And so in Dreaming Rivers, the narrative centers on broader themes of migration, specifically between St. Lucia and the United Kingdom. The story of the main character, Miss T, weaves together narratives on diaspora, intimacy, and kinship. Watching the film a good 30 years later brings about questions on how we engage stories on movement, migration, and the ongoing violence of the British Empire. In writing about the work, I wanted to think with and write to the film rather than writing about the film. And in a similar way, I used the conversation with Rahana, which started in 2017, and our multiple dialogues since then as a collaborative entry point for today's discussion. In thinking about collage, archives, and in particular stories on migration, diaspora, gender, and race, I've written about the importance of fragmentation. And so what I've been interested in is opening up a larger conversation on collage politics, in which we also consider how stories and archival materials might be used. Fragments and scatters in general are generative because they direct us towards other forms of reading and sensing the archive. Using fragments and scatters usually give us a different temporal account of how stories of migration and diaspora might evolve. An intimate listening to materials is not about giving voice to those who are forgotten within the archive, but rather seeks to understand how the materials of Black women and women of color might orientate us. This intimate listening practice generates an approach in which we do not only pay attention to materiality, but also to intangible performative gestures, such as rituals and behaviors that scholars like Jose Munoz and Diane Taylor describe in their work. Collage, in this sense, allows us to think about other forms of legibility. I think here also about how we might navigate the absence or presence of stories generated by Black and Brown women within the archive. There's a need here to consider how we might go beyond ideas of loss, presence, and absence. In other words, I'm interested in how we can use these two moving image examples to ask larger questions about the intersection between collage techniques, archives, and diaspora. Fragments and scatters are a generative tool of knowledge production to move against the need to offer coherent and linear narratives of migration and belonging. I just think of other ways to approach and write about artworks and film that draw or incorporate a multitude of collage techniques. And this is a reference to the earlier mentioned amorphous figure that appears in Tell Me the Story of All These Things. What does it mean to listen to archival fragments or to allow fragments to orientate us? There's an important multi-sensory experience in this approach. We tend to orientate towards the materials and stories as much as they orientate us. In this sense, fragments also have a cartographic quality. The very act of relating to materials opens up questions about the forms of possible relations. This is evidently true for artistic practice, but I also offer this as a way to break open how we write about art, race, and representation. In Tell Me the Story of These Things, we see a play with dislocation and intimacy. For instance, we get to see a close shot of hands grinding ginger, the cutting of onions, and stirring and marinating spices. I think here of the cultural and artistic inheritance that comes with exploring and showing the multiple modalities through which we get to engage with the intersections between food, diaspora, coloniality, and gender. I also want to mention the multimedia art project of Recipes of Resistance here, which is conceptualized by Raju Rage and other artists from the South Asian diaspora in the UK. In my initial conversation with Rahana in 2017, we spoke about Rahana's use of fragmentation in the work in relationship to Dictée, a 1982 book by Korean-American artist Theresa Cha, which brings together notes, thoughts, drawings, scribbles, and language. Ideas of fragmentation in this specific work do not just inform the use of narrative, but also the use of camera, light, and contrasting imagery. These textures enrich how we come to learn and sense different migratory journeys. In a similar sense, Atiyah's Dreaming Rivers continues to bring up ideas on how we come to know or experience the archive. Especially when it comes to thinking about Black British narratives on screen, there's an important pull to go beyond ideas of representation. Dreaming Rivers, coming forth out of the Sankofa Film and Video Collective, was part of the mid-1980s collective film practice formed by filmmakers of African, Afro-Caribbean, and South Asian descent. I'm interested in how the film orientates us towards broader questions on how belonging, mourning, and loss are narrated. Multiple uses of collage then also ask deeper questions about movement. In one of Zaman's latest work, Your Aesthetic Self, Rana's in conversation with her brother, Saeed. This companion piece to Tell Me the Story of All These Things, again stretching explorations of place, diaspora, and belonging. With the focus on her brother this time, we're asked to think about religion, desire, and the place of South Asian diaspora within the British landscape. Rahana converses with her brother while he drives. He speaks about his engagement with the philosophy and practice of Tantra. The car scenes are alternated with archival materials from Eagle Nest Dagger in the Hanza Valley in Pakistan. This footage presents a long-standing history of pre-Islamic ritual and communities. The valley is also a well-known tourist attraction and appeals to white Western hikers who partake in the witnessing of these rituals. Some of this footage is also available on YouTube, and it's really interesting to look at. The white tourist gaze in the footage then also poses a question on how to balance these overlapping narratives that touch on South Asian belonging and Orientalism, usually intersecting with Tantra narratives. Finally, the car scenes, the archival footage of the Hanza Valley, are alternated with footage of Rahana Zaman and Priya Jay gardening. There's an underlying question here about the British landscape and who it belongs to. And there's an indirect reference in this part of the footage to Ingrid Pollard's 1988 pastoral interlude. I'm interested in these multiple uses of movement and migration as form of collage. I don't think here about collage simply as migration or migrating as a form of collage, but rather how using these different techniques create new understandings of time and temporality. In our experience of these works, and even in writing and speaking about them, there's a potential to be differently in time. In this sense, I think about the intergenerational potential of reading multiple works in conversation with each other. Instead of thinking about movement and migration as a linear experience, we can then see how these works stall and drag time. They aren't progress narratives or narratives that necessarily move forward towards a settled idea of belonging. So I want to end here and hopefully pick up some of these larger ideas and questions during the Q&A. I hope I kept to the time.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Chandra. That was so interesting. And I think everybody will agree there are so many amazing intersection sort of woven through all these papers. So Allison, I'm going to invite you to pop your video back on, if that's all right, so that we can kick off with some questions. So again, just like in the last session, feel free to pop any questions that you might have into the Q&A and I can read them out. And yeah, off we go. So I'm going to go ahead though, while everybody's, I'm sure, furiously typing away at home. I'm going to go ahead and take my chair's prerogative, which I'm quite happy about. So one of the things I was hoping that you might pick up more, maybe talk a little bit more about, is the ways in which both of these practices do sort of maneuver, as you were just talking about, Chandra, but you know, also came up in your talk, Allison, with the generational, again, within this really sort of expanded field, if you like, of what collage is, right? So this idea, like you said, Allison, of the social collage in Sonia's sort of more recent works. So yeah, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about, yeah, that sense of generation and history on the one hand, and then the way that it is in sort of woven through this bigger question of absences and presences within collage, the things where things come from. Sorry, I don't know who wants to start. It's a big one, sorry.
Yeah, I think, you know, this intergenerational interaction for me really came through so strongly yesterday in the film that we watched with Judah Attil. I thought it was so ironic when I was thinking about all of the controversy that came up when Sonia removed the painting, because, you know, the other thing that she's been so involved with for the last couple of years is BAM, Black Artisan Modernism, which is about going into storage and finding all of those works, particularly by artists of color, that have been collected but not displayed. And so I think there is a real disconnect for the generations, because the institutions are still not responding in terms of making the work accessible in the way that it needs to be. And this came up, I think, you know, in the presentations earlier this morning, even in terms of the critical writing and the dialogue around the work. So it was fascinating in the film to see these younger practitioners literally being confronted with the materiality of the work of the generation before, and acknowledging, you know, that this is almost sacred. You know, is this really something that they can deal with? And yet how liberating it was. So I think it's, you know, clearly really important, and clearly something that we need to develop in a more meaningful and accessible way.
Brilliant, thank you. Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to fully agree. And I think, like, especially for, I mean, my generation, but also generations like after me, I think there's been this really interesting engagement with the archive, and specifically kind of, I'm thinking about, you know, Black British feminism, these legacies and kind of like, you know, art practices, but thinking about that kind of return to the archive, but then all the complexities that come with that, right? So I think that's also specifically, I guess, in relationship to any kind of, you know, use of archives, whether that's for like artistic practice or other like projects, is always that kind of grappling with what is there and what isn't there. But then also, I think what I'm really interested in is like, how do we also move away from thinking about like absence and presence as these very fixed kind of like junctures or entry points, which is difficult, because I think they're, you know, like, especially engaging with cultural production from the 1980s, it's like, you know, it's obviously incredible to see that as really generative. It's great to teach with that kind of material. But there are also other silences and gaps that hopefully they're, you know, different approaches to addressing that, which I think why collage, like kind of politics are so interesting, to play with those ideas of legibility and what becomes legible, and in kind of younger generations, use of archival, like collage, and this is not in reference to a UK artist, but a Black American artist that I really like, Alana Fields, who works with found images of Black queer presence kind of uses like lines and borders and glitters and different kind of things in her multimedia artworks to play with those ideas of legibility. And it's interesting to see how younger generations are also kind of thinking through ideas of collage.
Brilliant, thank you. I'm gonna go now to a question in the Q&A from Rosemary Cantwell, who asks, the subtext of some of the work seems to be about capitalism and the pursuit of wealth. How far is this about economics? And I think, Allison, maybe do you want to start with that one? My mind straight away went to, crop over and colonialism and.
Yeah, I mean, you know, so much of this work is kind of exposing systems of power, and capitalism obviously lies at the base of that. I don't know what else to say other than absolutely, this is, you know, a prevalent subtext. You know, as you know, money is what fuels the power.
Brilliant. Chandra, did you want to add anything?
I mean, I think very briefly, I think Allison already mentioned this around like the institutional politics and, you know, the broader conversations that people are having in the art world, especially around being brought in as like Black or Brown curators or art practitioners to have these very conversations that are alluded to in the question, and for them to kind of like step in and out of the institution. So obviously this is a larger kind of conversation about how we navigate like institutional politics and coming into those spaces without, you know, necessarily working towards long-term structural change.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And I think it was something that you touched on in your paper, Allison, as well, about this idea of sort of drawing on Walter de Mignolo's writing around, you know, sort of what does it mean to sort of dechain, sort of to take on these power systems by appropriating and dechaining and making new meanings, and yeah, and the power that collage has within that context.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, I'm not alone in being so excited about the upcoming Documenta, and you know, the way in which the organizers have decided to, you know, pretty much dismiss the traditional institutional infrastructures and really look at the social practices of you know, art as a practice, you know, that I think, you know, that's going to become increasingly important in terms of, you know, rethinking the landscape.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, what I found so striking about today is how we moved sort of from, this idea of cutting, you know, very quickly, where Amy introduces the idea of, you know, sort of cutting and pasting and the idea of glue and that sort of materiality, to now moving into spaces where we're conceiving, yeah, like you said, Chandra, the city of migration as collage and collage, you know, and so reframing these things in much, much broader sense. I'm gonna turn to the question box, where we have an anonymous question who, thanks Allison for your paper. Sonia Boyce's work evolved from 2D to 3D and has incorporated time-based media, durational performance and videos. Do you think her collage strategies have also changed as the time element becomes more prominent in the work?
The work has changed quite radically, but what was really striking for me, looking across sort of the decades of her work yet again, was how, you know, the core of her practice and the meaning of collage was there all along. And from an early age, she had a kind of a sense of what it was that she wanted to do with her work as a practitioner. And it has been a matter of kind of refining the language and just becoming remarkably open in her practice in terms of this idea of setting a stage and allowing things to unfold and just having confidence in her collaborators in terms of what the outcome will be. But you know, sort of the underlying ethic of her work to me has been there from the beginning.
Brilliant, thank you. So what I think we'll do now is, unless anybody has any sort of burning last minute questions that you might want to get in quite quickly now, is are we going to turn everybody back on and sort of come back together for a multi-panel discussion? So back over to you, Elena.
Hi there. Thank you everyone for really wonderful papers today. And as you said, Elizabeth, I feel that it was a wonderful sense of this opening up of the very notions of collage from the gritty materiality of the cutting up and pasting and putting together to collage intended as an aesthetic and a methodological approach that moves into a much larger social space. I also feel there has been quite a lot said today about the sort of status of those artists within the canon. And myself being a curator at the Tate, I feel a sort of urgent need to address this as a sort of questions that I just feel should not be avoided and were sort of inserted in quite a few of the discussions. I think there's certainly an issue with institutions, and I guess particularly Tate as being the national collection, but also there are other nationals, not collecting or only collecting works that pertain to a specific cultural moment in which notions of race and identity can be defined very squarely and ideally not assimilate with the main narrative. And I think this is something that I certainly very much recognize myself in, recognize the struggle of how incredibly difficult and slow a process it is. We are trying to learn very fast, change how we operate, and yet there is, you know, the machine is tense, continues. I mean, the main narrative of British art can only, I feel, be broken down very, very slowly. And I think what was also very interesting in the discussions today, there is also a resistance to do that. The resistance to the colorful, to the sexual female body, to the black body, to the queer body. And all of these, I think it means that change happens very quickly. And I don't want to focus on this subject. I just wanted to comment on it and give an opportunity for anyone else to expand on it if you wanted to.
Yeah, I mean, it's this frustration of the relationship between the institution as a machine and the individuals who make up the institution. How do they kind of, you know, generate that development, that progress? I had lots of thoughts running through my head as you were talking this is the challenge. And I think this discussion about the avoidance of sort of, you know, bright colors. I think as we kind of, we have this natural hesitancy to resist change, but as we start to understand why that is, as we start to kind of unpack our fear that we have about making the kind of progress that we need to make, hopefully that's the impetus that we need to do it better.
And I think is maybe a fear of the excessive, something that has been running through today, this fear of the non-contained, the shapeless, the colorful. I feel there is lots of this that was running through a number of papers.
Yeah.
And
Elena, can I just jump in? Just your thoughts made me think about, you know, these wider questions that we've been exploring across this week about where collage sits. And, you know, what you said makes me think about where collage sits institutionally and how it's collected and how it's been collected historically, and whether it's, you know, traditionally gone into like print rooms, it's seen, you know, works on paper, but of course a lot of the artworks and things that we've been talking about today and yesterday, you know, again, don't respect those boundaries, or the work, the cross media and going into film and sound, and, you know, so how this material is collected, and that still, you know, especially national collections and, you know, bigger institutions, predominantly we still do see a lot of painting and sculpture, you know, in on permanent hangs, and where you see material that doesn't quite fit or doesn't respect material boundaries, because it's difficult to look after. I think, you know, curatorially, it's difficult to store and manage and put on display sometimes. So I think those questions about where some of this material is, where it sits in the boundaries of the, or the categories of the history of art, and how it's collected and how it's exhibited, your comments just really made me think about that, and perhaps why we don't see so much of it institutionally as well is a big question.
Just building on that, I had a question actually for that could be opened up maybe to all of our speakers today, just about whether these practices that we've been talking about do generate these particularly kind of complex archives. And like you say, Sarah, it often doesn't go to the collection, it goes to the archive, these kind of ephemeral materials, things that are difficult to attribute. And I think that came across with Claire Zimmerman's example of Alison Smithson's scrapbook yesterday. You know, it's such a difficult object, and even to digitize some of these materials, there's all these copyright issues, because it's leaving a very complex archival trace, because it's already drawing on archival material, but often from this kind of broader cultural archive of kind of shared materials. And I think, Chandra, I thought your terminology around fragments and scatters, like often this kind of scattering through the archive of the traces of this kind of collage practice. But I was just wondering whether any of our contributors today wanted maybe to comment on their kind of encounter with these forms of collage in its more archival state.
Well, I mean, I could just say that I think it's very true that there's a lot of movement between the archive or the studio and the sort of finished work, so to speak. And I think it really is one of the very beneficial kind of like interesting like aspects of collage and photomontage practices, that they can dislodge some of these like associations or kind of absolute boundaries and categories. And I think what was really interesting, one point that Linda and I were working on the exhibition, we went to the Tate archive and looked at the Itel Colhoun collection, and there was a collage photo book in the collection, and we were sort of looking through it and taking pictures, and we gave all of these pictures to the designer, you know, to be like, this is what we were thinking about, this is the people we're interested in, and she just like took them to be Linda's work, right, you know, in this kind of really interesting way. And I just thought that was a sort of funny thing of you know, these kind of loose boundaries that Linda sometimes talks about being guided by the hand of Itel, like when she's talking about automatic practices. And there was like a literal merging together, that kind of past practice and present practice, that other artists might feel like, no, I didn't, my work cannot be mistaken for anyone else's work, you know, and maybe collage opens up some of those things that even that are the most kind of challenging, right, for us as art historians or curators working with art. And we should lean into it, maybe.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, Emmy, also in relation to that, it feels the last 4 days we have seen so much discussion around how collage in a way is conducive to forms of exchange, collaboration, gift, and collaborative practices, some of which, of course, we have also addressed today and yesterday between Atil and Sonia Boyce, and that sort of opening up to a shared debate. And I also feel there was something interesting today about the transition from self-portraiture to social or collective portraiture, which I think is very much part of a similar paradigm.
Can I just say that what I found really interesting about today's paper was the element of collaboration and response in each of the writers in terms of the subject they're talking about. And I don't know whether anybody wants to elaborate on that a bit more. I mean, Chandra made that quite explicit in terms of like writing to a film rather than about a film. And Amy's just brought up again, like kind of the sort of intense collaboration with Linda. And that seemed to really impact on the kind of curatorial choices that you made together. And I think everyone has mentioned exchanges with the artist. And just for me as a writer, I'm kind of interested how that's then impacted on your writing about these artists who really play with form, and whether that's kind of then sort of impacted on the kind of the form or the approach to their work.
I mean, I can just say very briefly, because I really love this question, because I think in all the years, like the more that I think I write or I'm invited to write, the more I think about form and experimentation and engagement. So it becomes this kind of, yeah, collaborative process, but also dialogue, but also exchange, but also what I think is this really interesting different form of orientation. So like kind of interpreting how these different artists orientate themselves to these broader histories, but then also my orientation to those stories, which I think for me was one of the reasons why I was like, I don't necessarily want to write about this. But since Rahana Zaman and I have been like in conversation since like 2017, and then I've written about like different like kind of film works, or we've been in conversation different iterations, it's become interesting that now the collaboration in terms of writing and analyzing and speaking about it has absolutely taken on also different shapes of thinking about how we as women of color navigate some of those conversations, and also how we do go beyond that idea of representation. Like we do think about like the potential of writing and collaborating as something that could also be a part of a liberation praxis, or, you know, and I think that's also quite interesting, because sometimes it's just about filling those gaps, like, oh, here's another artwork by a Black or Brown artist, and it's about representation, and it's doing X, Y, Z. And true writing, we also have this interesting kind of, I guess, possibility to do something different with how we're interpreting that work, and thereby also hopefully gently shifting sometimes some of the dominant like narrative around that. Yeah, I really like that question.
Thank you so much, everyone. I'm really sorry, but I think we need to draw to a close, as I know some of our speakers need to leave. I just want to thank you all again for your papers, your sharing, all the contributions from the audience, and hopefully we will see some of you again next week for our workshops. Bye.
Thank you. Bye, everybody.